Welcome. In today's lecture, we will study Kelly-Hamilton theorem. The subject code is MA151 and the subject name is Mathematics First. So, we will study Kelly-Hamilton theorem. This theorem is a very interesting theorem and it gives a very general result. Kelly-Hamilton theorem's statement can be given in this way, that every square matrix satisfies its own characteristic equation. We have studied how to calculate characteristic equation or eigenvalue equation. Now, Kelly-Hamilton theorem states that every square matrix, so it will be applicable to all these square matrices, every square matrix will satisfy the characteristic equation of the given matrix. For example, if we have a matrix A of order n cross n, so it is a square matrix, then this square matrix, for this square matrix A, we know that the characteristic equation of A will be given by this equation, determinant A minus lambda I equal to 0. So, the characteristic equation of a matrix of order n is this, determinant A minus lambda I equal to 0. Further, if we will open the determinant which is on the left hand side, then we will get a polynomial in lambda of degree n. As we have seen, when we write a characteristic equation for a 2 by 2 matrix, then we get a quadratic polynomial, means a polynomial in power having highest power 2 in lambda, and when we take a 3 by 3 matrix, then we get a cubic polynomial in the characteristic equation having highest power of lambda equal to 3. Similarly, if we will expand, we will use n cross n square matrix, then we will get a characteristic polynomial of degree n having highest power of lambda equal to n. So, for example, so in this case we will get a polynomial. I am writing the representative form of the polynomial. Suppose we get lambda to the power n plus c1 lambda n minus 1 plus c2 lambda n minus 2 plus n, so on, and at the end if we get cn equal to 0. So, cn is a constant term. So, in total we will have n plus 1 terms in the characteristic polynomial of a matrix, square matrix of order n. So, the c1, c2, cn will be different for every matrix. Now, suppose if, so this equation is a characteristic equation for a matrix of order n. Now, if after this, according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, this square matrix will satisfy its own characteristic equation. So, we should have, according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, we should have a to the power n plus c1, a to the power n minus 1 plus c2, a to the power n minus 2 plus and so on, plus cn into I equal to a null matrix. So, according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, this matrix equation will hold. So, this is the meaning of saying that the square matrix A satisfies this equation in lambda, this characteristic equation. Here, you can note down these two things. I is an identity matrix of order n cross n. So, it is identity matrix. and this O is a zero matrix or null matrix of order n cross n. So these two symbols are different than the original characteristic equation. In original characteristic equation, we have replaced lambda by A everywhere, but here in place of Cn, we are writing Cn into I, and in place of simple zero, we are writing a zero matrix, because it is a matrix equation. So in place of 1, we will have I, and in place of 0, we will have a null matrix. So this I was explaining with the help of n cross n matrix. Now suppose if we have a 2 by 2 matrix, then for 2 by 2 matrix, our characteristic equation will be of this form: lambda square plus c1 lambda plus c2 equal to 0. In this case, according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, this square matrix will satisfy its characteristic equation. So according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, we should have a square plus c1a plus c2i equal to a null matrix. Similarly, for a matrix of order 3 by 3, our characteristic equation will be of this form, having highest power of 3, having highest power 3 of lambda. So lambda cube plus c1 lambda square plus c2 lambda plus c3 equal to 0. This represents the characteristic equation of a 3 by 3 matrix. And in this case, according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, a cube plus c1 a square plus c2 a plus c3 I equal to will be equal to the zero matrix. So this is the meaning of Kelly-Hamilton theorem. Further, on Kelly-Hamilton theorem, there will be two types of problems in this course, MA 151. Number one type of problem will be on verifying Kelly-Hamilton theorem, and second type of problems will be on the calculation of inverse by applying Kelly-Hamilton theorem. So I explain working rules for both the types of problems one by one. So first type of problem will be on verify Kelly-Hamilton theorem. In these types of problems, we will calculate, first we will calculate the characteristic equation so first we will find the characteristic equation of the given matrix A. After the calculation of given matrix A, we will find the matrix equation. We will find a matrix equation by replacing lambda from the matrix A. So as we have obtained here, so we will write this type of matrix equation, and then we will verify this type of matrix equation, and that will verify the Kelly-Hamilton theorem. And verify it. So these will be the working rules for the first type of problem on verifying Kelly-Hamilton theorem. Second, to find inverse by applying Kelly-Hamilton theorem. So in brief, I am writing CH theorem. So to find inverse by Kelly-Hamilton theorem, we will use this matrix equation. For example, I illustrate the calculation of inverse for a 3 by 3 matrix. So, if we have a 3 by 3 matrix, we can calculate the characteristic equation, and then according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, we can write this equation, and for the first type of problem, we can verify it. Now, for the second type of problem, to find inverse by Kelly-Hamilton theorem, what we will do? We will multiply this resulting matrix equation by A inverse. To have, if we will multiply such a matrix equation by A inverse, then we will get A square plus C1A plus C2I plus C3A inverse equal to 0 matrix. So you can observe, if you will multiply A inverse with A cube, we will get A square. If we multiply A inverse with A square, we will get A. If we multiply A inverse with A, then we will get I. And if we multiply A inverse with I, then we will get A inverse. And if we multiply A inverse with null matrix, we will get a null matrix. So, after obtaining this type of equation, we will be able to write the value of inverse in the form of this relation. A inverse will be equal to minus 1 upon C3 into A square plus C1A plus C2I. So, A inverse will be equal to minus 1 upon C3 A square plus C1A plus C2I. So, we can find value of A inverse by applying Kelly-Hamilton theorem by calculating only A square. We will have A from the given problem. We know what is the value of I, and we can calculate A square from A. So, simply calculating A square and substituting the values of A square, A and I here on the right hand side, we will get the value of A inverse. So, we will have two types of problems in Kelly-Hamilton theorem. Now, I take a 2 by 2 matrix and illustrate both the types of problems for a 2 by 2 matrix, and then we will take a 3 by 3 matrix, and then we will study these two types of problems for the 3 by 3 matrix also. So, I consider a 2 by 2 matrix. Suppose the 2 by 2 matrix given to us is 2, 5, 1, minus 3, and the question, the language of the question is like this, that verify Kelly-Hamilton theorem for this given matrix A, and also and hence find out the inverse. So the question runs like this, that verify Kelly-Hamilton theorem for this matrix and find the inverse of the matrix by applying Kelly-Hamilton theorem, or using, or we may have verify simply, verify Kelly-Hamilton theorem and hence find inverse. So that means to find inverse by applying Kelly-Hamilton theorem. So to verify Kelly-Hamilton theorem, first we need to calculate characteristic equation. So we know characteristic equation of any matrix is given by this equation. For 2 by 2 matrix, this equation will be 2 minus lambda 5 1 minus 3 minus lambda equal to 0. And now we calculate this 2 by 2 determinant to have 2 minus lambda into minus 3 minus lambda minus 5 equal to 0. When we multiply, we get minus 6 and plus 3 lambda, and then we get minus 2 lambda and plus lambda square minus 5 equal to 0. On simplifying, we will get lambda square plus lambda and minus 11 equal to 0. So you can verify your calculation because you have multiplied here two linear factors. So we are getting minus 6 and plus 3 lambda and minus 2 lambda and plus lambda square, and minus 5 is here, and after that we collected lambda square, and the terms containing lambda will be only 1 into lambda. So I have written plus lambda, and minus 6 minus 5 will become minus 11. So this is our characteristic equation for the given matrix. Now to verify Kelly-Milton theorem, we will write the corresponding matrix equation according to Kelly-Milton theorem. So according to Kelly-Milton theorem, for this matrix A square plus A minus 11i will be equal to 0, a null matrix. So to verify Kelly-Milton theorem, we will verify this matrix equation. So to verify this matrix equation, we need the value of A square. So because we have the value of A, we know I, so we need to calculate the value of A square. So we calculate the value of A square by multiplying these two matrices A and A, 2, 5, 1, minus 3, and 2, 5, minus, 2, 5, 1, minus 3. So if we perform this multiplication, we will get 2 into 2, 4, plus 5, 9, and then 10, minus 15, minus 5, and then 2, minus 3, minus 1, and then 5, plus 9, 14. So after multiplying A and A, we will get the value of A square. Now after the calculation of A square, we will substitute the value of A square and the value of A and the value of I here on the left hand side. So left hand side will be 9 minus 5 minus 1 14 plus A means 2 5 1 minus 3 minus 11 I. So I can write 11 0 0 11 in place of 11 I. Now we calculate this addition and subtraction of matrices. So we will have 9 plus 2 minus 11, so here we will have 0, minus 5 plus 5 0, so here we will have 0, minus 1 plus 1 0 minus 0, so here we will have 0, 14 minus 3 minus 11, so 14 minus 14, so here again we will have 0. So in this way we get a null matrix which verifies Kelly-Milton theorem. So we have verified this equation, that means we have verified Kelly-Milton theorem. Now to find inverse of this matrix by the use of Kelly-Milton theorem, as explained previously, what we will do, we will multiply A inverse to this characteristic equation. So after multiplying A inverse with this matrix equation, which have been obtained from the characteristic equation by replacing lambda from A. So if we multiply it by A inverse, we will get A plus I minus 11 A inverse equal to 0. So in this way, we will get that A inverse will be equal to 1 upon 11 into A plus I. Now after this, we can calculate the value of A inverse simply by calculating A plus I. We know A is 2, 5, 1, minus 3, and I is 1, 0, 0, 1. So when we will add, on the diagonal 1 will be added. On the diagonal of A matrix, 1 will be added. So we will have 3 and minus 2. And other elements will remain unchanged, because we are adding an identity matrix. So this will be the inverse of A. So here we have calculated A inverse by applying Kelly-Milton theorem. So This was the illustration of problem on Kelly-Milton theorem with a 2 by 2 matrix. Now we take a 3 by 3 matrix and solve the problems on Kelly-Milton theorem on verifying the Kelly-Milton theorem and to find inverse. So this time I am considering a 3 by 3 matrix. Suppose our 3 by 3 matrix is 0, 1, 2, 1, 0, minus 1 and 2, minus 1, 0. Suppose this 3 by 3 matrix is given. 0, 1, 2, 1, 0, minus 1, 2, minus 1, 0. And the question has been asked that you verify Kelly-Milton theorem for this square matrix and hence find inverse. In that case, we will calculate the characteristic equation of this matrix A. Now, characteristic equation is given by definite A minus lambda I equal to 0. We know this formula. We can apply this formula to calculate the characteristic equation of this square matrix A. We know alternative way to find characteristic equation of a 3 by 3 matrix. So we can apply that alternative way to find characteristic equation. Now that alternative method to find characteristic equation says us that the characteristic equation of a 3 by 3 matrix will be lambda cube minus s1 lambda square plus s2 lambda minus s3 equal to 0, where s1 will be equal to the sum of the diagonal element, which will be 0 here, and S2 will be the sum of the minus of the principal diagonal element. So I calculate minus of all the principal diagonal elements and I will add those to get the value of S2. So first I calculate minus of this 0. So I will remove this column and this row. So my minus will be 0 minus plus 1, so minus 1. Now I calculate minor of this 0 on 2 2 position. So I will remove second row and second column. So my minor will be minus 4. And now I calculate minor of 0 which is on 3 3 position. So I will get minus 1. So the value of S2 is minus 6. Next we calculate S3. We know that S3 will be equal to the determinant of the given matrix. And we can easily calculate the determinant of the given matrix by applying our SOR trick to find the value of a determinant of order 3 by 3. So I calculate the value of determinant. So to calculate the value of determinant, first I multiply all the three entries on the principal diagonal. We get 0. Then I multiply 1, minus 1 and 2. Then we get minus 2. After this I multiply 1, minus 1, 2. Again we get minus 2. Minus. Then we calculate along opposite diagonal. So we multiply 2, 0, 2. So we get 0. After this we multiply minus 1, 0, so we get 0. After this we multiply 1, 1, 0, again we get 0. Now we observe that the value of S3 will be minus 4. So in this way we have calculated the values of S1, S2, S3. So we can write characteristic equation of the given matrix in this form, lambda cube minus S1, S1 is 0 and plus S2 lambda, so minus 6 lambda, and then S3 means minus S3, so we will have plus 4 equal to 0. So this will be the characteristic equation of the given square matrix. So lambda cube minus 6 lambda plus 4 is the characteristic equation of the given matrix A. Now, after this, according to Kelly-Milton theorem, the square matrix A will satisfy its own characteristic equation. So we should have, according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, we should have A cube minus 6A plus 4I equal to a null matrix. Now, to verify Kelly-Hamilton theorem, we will verify this equation. So we need the value of A cube. We know the value of A and we know the value of I. So to calculate the value of A cube, first we need to find A square. To find A square, we will multiply A matrix with A matrix. So I write A matrix two times. (0, 1, 2, 1, 0, -1, 2, -1, 0). So in this way, we can calculate A square. Now we calculate A square. So A square will be 0, 1, 4. We will have 5, 0, 0, minus 2. So here we will have minus 2. Next, we multiply first row with third column. So we will have 0, minus 1, 0. So we will have minus 1. After this, we multiply second row with first column. So we will have 0, 0, minus 2. Next, we will have 1, 0, 1. So we will have 2. After this, we multiply second row with third column. So we will have 2. 0, 0. So we will have 2 here. Next, we multiply third row. So 0, minus 1, 0. So we will have minus 1. 2, 0, 0. So we will have 2 here. Next, we multiply third row with third column. So we will get 4, 1, 0. So we will have 5 here. So in this way, we have calculated A square. 5 minus 2, minus 1, minus 2, 2, 2, minus 1, 2, 5. After the calculation of A square, we can calculate A cube by multiplying A square and A. So we have A square equal to 5, minus 2, minus 1, minus 2, 2, 2, minus 1, 2, 5. And A is equal to this 0, 1, 2, 1, 0, minus 1, 2, minus 1, 0. Now we multiply these two matrices to have the value of A cube. So we will have 0, minus 2, minus 2. We will have minus 4 here. We will have 5, 0, 1. So we will have 6. 0, 2, 4. Okay. So we need to calculate the third element of first row also. So we multiply first row with third column. So 10, 2, and 0. So we will have 12 here. Now we multiply second row with first column. So 0, 2, 4. So we will have 6 here. Minus 2, 0, minus 2. So we will have minus 4 here. Minus 4, minus 2, 0. So minus 4, minus 2, 0. So we will have minus 6 here. 0, 2, 10. So we will have 12 here. And then minus 1, 0, minus 5. So we will have minus 6 here. And then we multiply third row with third column. So we will have minus 2, minus 2, and 0. So we will have minus 4 here. So in this way, we have obtained A cube equal to minus 4, 6, 12, 6, minus 4, minus 6, 12 minus 6 minus 4. Now we have a cube, we know the value of a and we know the value of I. After substituting the values of a cube, a and I on the left hand side of this equation, this matrix equation, you will get a null matrix, and that will verify the Carey-Hamilton theorem. So in this way I have illustrated the application of Carey-Hamilton theorem in finding the how to verify Carey-Hamilton theorem by calculating characteristic equation, and then how to verify it by calculating the corresponding powers of the required powers of the matrix. Next we will look at the calculation of inverse. So to find inverse of this matrix A by applying Carey-Hamilton theorem, what we will do, we will multiply A inverse with this matrix equation. So we will get A square minus 6i plus 4A inverse equal to 0 matrix. So from this formula, the value of A inverse will be equal to 1 by 4 6i minus A square, and we know the value of I and we know the value of A square, so we can calculate the value of A inverse very easily by subtracting these two matrices, 6i and A square. So in this way I have illustrated two types of problems. First, how to verify Carey-Hamilton theorem for a 3 by 3 matrix. Now to find inverse by the use of Carey-Hamilton theorem. Further, in the previous lecture we have studied diagonalization of matrices. Diagonalization of matrices and Carey-Hamilton theorem both can be used to calculate powers of the matrices also. So that we will see next, how to calculate powers of a matrix by applying diagonalization and Carey-Hamilton theorem. So powers of matrices, so I will write square matrices, because the power of matrices is also defined for square matrices only. To calculate powers, any power of a square matrix by applying diagonalization process, we have studied that we obtain diagonalization by this formula, D equal to P inverse AP. So if P A is a given matrix, then we calculate the eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the matrix A, and then we calculate the model matrix P, and after that we calculate the inverse of P. After the calculation of P inverse, we evaluate the value of P inverse AP, and this gives us a diagonalized form of the given matrix which will have eigenvalues on the principal diagonal. Now to find powers, any power of it, suppose you want to calculate A to the power N, then to calculate A to the power N, we can apply this formula, P into D to the power N P inverse. We will be having values of P and P inverse from the diagonalization process, and the value of D to the power N will be very straightforward to calculate. For example, if we have a diagonal matrix, for example, if I have a diagonal matrix A 0 0 0 B 0 0 0 C, so any power of this type of diagonal matrix will be equal to a matrix having same powers of the diagonal element only. So in this way we can easily calculate any power of diagonal matrix, and we can write the n power of diagonal matrix here, and using this formula we can calculate the corresponding power of the square matrix A. So this is the idea to find any power of A by the diagonalization process. Next we will look at the calculation of powers by Kelly-Hamilton theorem. So to calculate the power by Kelly-Hamilton theorem, I illustrate the idea with the help of a 2 by 2 matrix. So for 2 by 2 matrix, our characteristic equation will be a quadratic equation in lambda. So lambda square plus c1 lambda plus c2 equal to 0. So for a 2 by 2 matrix, the characteristic equation will be of this form, lambda square plus c1 lambda plus c2 equal to 0. Now according to Kelly-Hamilton theorem, a square plus c1a plus c2i will be a null matrix. Alternatively, I can write that a square will be equal to minus c1a minus c2i. Now if I multiply this equation with a, then on the left I will have a cube, and on the right I will have minus c1a square minus c2a. Now we know that a square from the first equation, this equation, the value of a square can be expressed in terms of capital A and capital I. So if we will substitute the value of a square here, then we will have minus c1 dash a square minus c2 dash I, minus c1 dash a minus c2 dash I, because a square can be converted in terms of a and I. So we can convert a, we can calculate a cube with the help of capital A and capital I only, where the values of c1 dash and c2 dash will be different than the c1 and c2. So in this way we can also calculate any other higher powers of A. So your A4 will be equal to minus c1 a cube minus c2 a square. Again from equation number 1 and 2 we can write the values of a cube and a square in terms of a and I only. So we can calculate a4 from the original matrix A and the identity matrix. So in this way we can calculate any power of the given square matrix by using simple addition, subtraction, constant, multiplication, scalar multiplication of the matrices. So if we will write the values of a cube and a square, then we may get a relation of this form, where c1 double dash and c2 double dash will be some fixed constant, and the values of c1 double dash, c2 double dash will be of course different than c1 c2 and c1 dash c2 dash. So these are the ideas to find powers of matrices by applying diagonalization and by applying Kelly-Hamilton theorem. Next we will look at the some of the properties of eigenvalues, and we will solve some problems on the properties of problems which can be solved by applying the properties of eigenvalues. So next next we look at the properties of eigenvalue. Properties of eigenvalues are useful in verifying our answer of the problems on eigenvalues. So, how the properties of eigenvalue will help us in verifying our answers on the problems of calculation of eigenvalues, that we can see from the first and second property. The first property says that sum of eigenvalues of a square matrix capital A will be equal to the sum of the diagonal elements of the given square matrix A, sum of the main diagonal, principal diagonal elements. And second, the product of eigenvalues, the product of eigenvalues of A will be equal to the determinant of A. So, whenever we solve a problem on calculation of eigenvalue, then after calculating the eigenvalues, we can check whether sum of our eigenvalue is equal to the sum of the main diagonal elements of the matrix A or not. And in this way, we can verify our answer on the eigenvalues. Further, we can use product of eigenvalues. So, we can check whether the product of eigenvalue is equal to the value of the determinant or not. So, if in any problem we find that the sum of our eigenvalue is not equal to the sum of the main diagonal elements, then we should recheck our calculations. So, in this way, we can verify our answers on the problems of calculation of eigenvalues. Further properties of eigenvalues are there. These properties states that suppose if I have a matrix A and if I calculate some eigenvalues and if I have one eigenvalue denoted by lambda I, I may have many eigenvalues lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 for a given square matrix according to the order of the square matrix. So here I am taking for example, if I have a square matrix A and lambda I is the corresponding eigenvalue, then according to the properties of eigenvalue, any power of A, A to the power n will have an eigenvalue lambda I to the power n. So for example, if I have a matrix of order 3, then lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3 are 3 eigenvalues of A, then in that case the eigenvalues of A to the power n will be lambda 1 to the power n, lambda 2 to the power n and lambda 3 to the power n. Similarly, eigenvalues of A inverse will be equal to reciprocal of the eigenvalues of the original square matrix A. Similarly, if we have a polynomial, suppose if I have A square minus 3A plus I, if the eigenvalue of A is lambda I, then one eigenvalue of A square minus 3A plus I will be equal to lambda I square minus 3 lambda I plus I plus 1. So, in this you can consider any square matrix and you can try to verify all these properties for that square matrix. And you will find that all these properties are verified for any square matrix. Now, we will look at a problem based on these two properties, because in that problem you will find that the given square matrix is of order 4. So the calculation of eigenvalues will be not helpful in solving those types of problems. So I write that question here. Suppose we have a matrix of order 4, 2, 3, 1, 5, 5, 2, 3, 4, 6, 4, 5, minus 9, 0, 5, 8, 0. So we have a matrix of order 4 by 4. Now the question is, find the sum and product of eigenvalues of the given square matrix A. Now you can observe that it is a 4 by 4 matrix, so the calculation of eigenvalues will be very time consuming, because we will have a 4 by 4 determinant for the characteristic equation, and to open that 4 by 4 determinants we need to simplify 4 3 by 3 determinants. Okay. So here in the question, only the sum and product of the eigenvalues of A is asked. So only the sum and product of eigenvalues of A are asked. So we can use these two properties to find sum of eigenvalues of A. We can sum the principal diagonal elements of the given matrix, the main diagonal elements of the given matrix, which are, so the sum of eigenvalues will be equal to 2 plus 2 plus 5 plus 0. And to find the product of the eigenvalues, we need to calculate the determinant of this 4 by 4 matrix. So the determinant of the calculation of determinant of 4 by 4 matrix will also require the calculation of 4 3 by 3 determinants if we simply open it from any row or any column. So what I will suggest is that you apply elementary row operations on the determinant of this matrix to have 2 or 3 zeros, to have 2 or 3 zeros in any row or in any column. So what we can do is that we can try to open this 4 by 4 determinant from 4th row. So if you will open it from 4th row, you will need to calculate only 2 3 by 3 determinants. And after getting 3 by 3 determinants, we know the short trick to calculate the value of the 3 by 3 determinants. So we will be able to find the value of this 4 by 4 determinants. And suppose if this type of problem is asked only for 3 by 3 matrix, then that problem will be straightforward. The sum of the main diagonal elements will give us the sum of eigenvalues, and the calculation of that 3 by 3 determinants will give us the product of the eigenvalues. So in this way, I conclude my today's lecture.